पतितानां पावनेभ्यो वैष्णवेभ्यो नमो नमः। जय श्री कृष्ण चैतन्य प्रभु नित्यानंद श्री अद्वैत गदाधार श्रीवासादि गौर भक्तवृंद। हरे कृष्णा 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 हरे हरे, हरे रामा राम राम हरे हरे, हरे कृष्णा। सो Today we enter to the next chapter of the fifth canto, of the ninth canto, the fifth chapter. And this chapter contains the, in one sense, geographically or locationally speaking, Durvasa Muni has gone from the earth all the way to Vaikuntha. So he has gone to the highest level of existence. But he doesn't have access to the highest power over there. Am I not audible?
We can hear you.
Okay. So, he has gone to the highest level of existence. And from there, now, he is required to come back. So the highest, he's told, so the Bhagavatam last chapter ends at that, we could say some kind of dramatic twist, that although he has gone geographically to a very high level, he doesn't get any access to divine grace or spiritual power at that level. He gets that access only at the level of the earth. So he's gone all the way up and he's coming back down. He's coming back down to seek the forgiveness of Ambarish Maharaj. And that theme is relevant in understanding also how we can face challenges in our life. We talked about in the yesterday session that whenever we face problems in life, broadly speaking, we can say our problems arise from, firstly there are problems that arise from nature's own, we could say providence, and then they are further aggravated by incompetence, which could be ours or others' incompetence, and then they are further worsened by malevolence. Malevolence is where we end up making, so there are some people who profit in others' pain. So when that happens, then things become quite unbearable. So in this section, I talked yesterday also about how these problems, they come, how we applied that to Ambarish Maharaj's pastime. And then I also talked about how that can be applied to the current COVID crisis that we are facing. So this principle can apply for all of us also. Let's look at it in today's setting. So how does Krishna help us deal with these problems? We see here at one level, Durvasa Muni did not get any solution from Krishna or Vishnu directly. So the solution he got was not that he didn't get a solution. It was not that Vishnu stopped or removed the Sudarshan Chakra, the danger for him immediately. He told him, go back to Ambarish Maharaj. And going back to Ambarish Maharaj at one level is a very humbling thing for him to do. That the very person whom he was angry with, who he felt had insulted him, now he has to go and seek forgiveness from him. But what that action signifies is even more important. That his submission to a devotee indicates his acknowledgement of the power of devotion as is manifested through a devotee. So God's ultimate power is accessed not so much by reaching God, but by actually cultivating devotion, by submitting to those who are associated with his, those who are devoted to him, and thus countering the challenges that we may face in life. So many times in such a situation that we face in life, when we face distresses, the question comes up that, okay, I'm in trouble and I'm seeking help from God. I may be praying, but where is God And where is God's help in this situation? So let's look at these three broad problems and understand how the Lord's love can be seen amid these problems. So at one level, let's consider providence. When there are problems because of providence, that means that they are just beyond our control. So yesterday I gave the example of somebody driving and being caught in a storm. So by providence itself, there are various kinds of problems that come in the world. Now, what do we do while dealing with those problems? The Lord's help, if we think that Krishna will help me by removing those problems magically. Yes, Krishna can do it sometimes. But in the world, problems are going to recur. And if somebody, we may think that I can achieve this and I can achieve that. We can achieve so many things. We think we can achieve so many things. But we can't even scratch our own back. If we get an itch in our back, we can't reach our back fully and scratch an itch. So suppose somebody has a very strong sensation on some part of their back and they can't scratch it. And that is causing them great annoyance, great irritation. And then they pray to God, oh God, help me. And God comes before them and says, what do you want? He says, please scratch my back. Well, if at all you have to ask God for something, okay, even if God scratches the back, release of the itch, the itch is going to come back again. At all we can ask God for something far greater. That is ultimately to cure the itch. So in one sense, we have various distresses in the world. We have various sources of dissatisfaction and trouble in the world. And yes, we may seek help of God at those times. And it's good. Krishna says that is Sukrutina. Those who appeal to Krishna at that time, they are Sukrutina. They are good people. But ultimately, Krishna's help is in raising our consciousness above the distressful material level to the spiritual level. So the rising the consciousness to the spiritual level doesn't just mean that we neglect the sufferings of the world. It means we learn to see beyond the distresses of the world. We acknowledge the distresses, but we see beyond the distresses. So Krishna in the Bhagavad Gita says, let's understand this point a little bit more. When we talk about how Krishna helps us deal with the sufferings that come out of providence. So as I said yesterday, I'll talk about dealing with the problems. Both we can place ourselves in Ambarish Maharaj's position and we can place ourselves in Durvasa Muni's position and see how this principle gets enacted out. But if I want to consider, say, if you consider providence and if I say transcendence is Krishna's help. So how does transcendence help us? See, Krishna in the Gita says that this world is Dukkhalaya. That this world is a place of distress. That is in 8.15. And if we start with the Gita itself, we clearly see that Arjuna is Dukhi. Arjuna is in distress, as we see in 2.1 when he is filled with tears. When his eyes are filled with tears. So Krishna doesn't say over there, oh, this world is a place of distress. Arjuna, you are in distress. So you have realized the nature of the world. And that's the end of it. No. While acknowledging the nature of the stressful nature of the world, Krishna provides Arjuna resources by which he can transcend the distressful nature of the world. So if we consider this is a place of distress, Dukkhalaya. So alaya is literally, if you translate the word alaya, means place. And if we consider distress, that is dukkha. So does this mean that there is nothing but distress in the world? Not exactly. If you consider Himalaya, Himalayas are the mountains, famous mountains. So they are the place of snow. So now if you consider in the Himalayas, is there only snow there? No. There are beautiful sights over there. There is exquisite natural scenery. There are some kind of wildlife which may grow over there. There are people who go to climb the Mount Everest. So there is, it's not that there is only snow, but the point is that snow will always have a place there, no matter what you do. That means we cannot find on the Himalayas a place which is not having snow, if you're actually in the Himalayas. It's for temporarily, sometimes a little heat might be there and the snow might go away. But ultimately, snow is going to be there over there. So this, the Dukkhale doesn't mean that there is, that it doesn't mean not, snow will always have a place. Not that snow is the only thing in that place. So similarly, Dukkhalaya doesn't mean that Dukkha is the only thing that is there in this place, in this world. Yes, distress is there in this world. And sometimes the distress is very acute. Say when we find a relationship crumbling, or we get a severe sickness, or when we lose our job or something like that, we have acute distress at that time. But there may not be, if there's no acute, if you consider this point, that Dukkhalaya, what this means is that if there is no acute, either there is, okay, put it this way, either there is acute distress or there is chronic dissatisfaction. We may not always feel severe distress in our life, but when do we really feel satisfied with everything in our life? Everything in our life is just perfect. It never happens. So there is some nagging dissatisfaction which is always there. So distress will always be there in this world, but that is not all that is there in this world. The world also provides resources for the pursuit of something higher. Ultimately, higher consciousness. Just like in the Himalayas, there is snow everywhere and somebody can just die because of the snow. But the Himalayas also provide a person opportunity for adventure. A person can go to the top of the Everest and achieve something heroic. So similarly, we also, in this material world, we have the opportunity to achieve something heroic. The world, while there is distress, and distress can't be avoided in this world, but it's not only distress. The world provides us resources for the pursuit of higher consciousness. What are those resources? There are various resources. There's Krishna, who himself provides knowledge through scripture. So Krishna gives knowledge, jnana through scripture, through shastra. He gives buddhi through as Paramatma. Then the super soul in our heart. Then there are vibhutis in the world. Through scripture, he uses knowledge. And the indwelling super soul is the voice of conscience, the voice of spiritual prompt, spiritual inquiry, spiritual intelligence. Then vibhuti in the world. Vibhuti means that there are attractive things in the world which direct our consciousness towards something higher, something grander. And they remind us when we say, go and see the beauty of the Niagara Falls. You know, we are reminded that there is a majesty and magnificence to the world which extends far beyond our human capacities. If you look at the night sky and see its vastness and its beauty with stars lighting it up, it reminds us of our smallness and the existence's greatness. And all these direct our consciousness towards something higher. So while there is distress in this world, and that's just an unavoidable reality, what Krishna provides us is resources for transcendence, resources for transcending our consciousness. And that's how we can deal with these providential distresses. So now providential distresses are there and we need resources for dealing with them. Let's come back. Now, incompetence. If we consider, what does incompetence mean? I mentioned that yesterday, that incompetence can make bad things worse. If somebody is in a fire and they don't know how to douse a fire, and they throw something which is inflammable toward the fire to extinguish it, and that causes the fire to spread, that's incompetence. So how do we deal with that? So what happens is we all have been given abilities by Krishna. Paurusham Rishu. So while we all can be incompetent in various ways, Krishna himself provides us, so we could say, from incompetence to competence. So if you see, as human beings, we are innately progress seeking. We want to improve things. Whatever situation we are in, we long to improve. So for example, if we have cows, now a cow will eat grass and will keep eating grass day after day, month after month, year after year, generation after generation for millions of years. So example, if you say food, cow eats same grass, but we humans, we want to improve our food. We create newer ways of cooking. We are never preparing food. Whether it is our food, whether it is our residence, we try to improve things. This is innate nature within humanity. Human beings have been given this capacity. We have all been given special abilities by which we try to improve things. So, in one sense, the Vedic system, so at one level, we humans have abilities. And another point is that the world is a place with real problems. And we need real skills or resources, skills to tackle real problems. And the whole system of Varnashram, which was there in the past, Varnashram was meant to deploy people's resources in the best possible way for dealing with problems. So there is a problem of lack of administration in the world. If things are not administered properly, everything will become chaotic. So then find out the people who have administrative skills and engage them so that they can deal with that problem. So there is, now we have various needs and resources which we require in the life, and those have to be provided for. So that is where trade, business, agriculture, all that comes in. So find out people who have those skills and engage them accordingly. So there is, we can say Varnashram is a system. The system of Varnashram was training people to become competent and then engaging competent people to the best use of society. So we all have this ability and this responsibility that whatever we are doing, if we want to minimize the problems we are facing, we need to learn competence. Say if you are driving a car, if we are going to drive it incompetently, we become a hazard for ourselves and hazard for others. So if we learn to become competent, so everything that we do, we as humans, it is a responsibility to try to do it as well as we can. That is something which is up to us. So human incompetence, the problems that come because of human incompetence cannot be blamed on God. And in one sense, there are different people who are given different abilities. And all of us, if we use the abilities that we have, then so actually, if we can say the power of competence, if all of us used fully whatever abilities we have been gifted, we all could actually make our life and our world so much better. So that is our responsibility. What will happen is that we see Arjuna as an example. Arjuna strove to become an expert archer. That was his service. So when Arjuna won the Kurukshetra war, was it because Krishna was with him? Of course. But was it just because Krishna was with him? Yes, Krishna was with him, but Arjuna himself didn't rely only on Krishna. I think Krishna will take care of everything. Arjuna trained tirelessly throughout his life to become an expert archer. Now, Arjuna did not necessarily know at that time, say when he was training as an archer, Arjuna didn't necessarily know that in the future, there is going to be a war. And in that, that will be a Dharma Yuddha. And at that time, I will be called upon to use my archery skills in Krishna's service. No, Arjuna knew that was his dharma, and he did his dharma. He strove to become competent in his dharma. So in one sense, dharma means to do our roles competently. So whatever be our role, some of us may have some roles in society which can be directly connected with spirituality. Say, if we are good at singing, we can directly sing for Krishna. If you're good at speaking, we can speak about Krishna. Some of us may not have skills or roles that are directly related with Krishna. But every one of us contributes to maintaining the fabric of society. So, Krishna talks about this as Loka Sangraha. Loka Sangraha means that each one of us, Loka Sangraha literally means, Sangraha means to bring together. So prevent the disintegration of the world. So Sangraha is integration. So what Krishna says is, he talks about this in the third chapter, that Loka Sangraham evapi sampashyan kartum arhasi. That if we don't do our responsibilities properly, we will cause the disintegration of the world. So Krishna says to Arjuna, do your duty. Krishna talks about doing your advanced duty at various levels. But one level he talks about is, do your duty to maintain social order. So all of us may have various roles in society, whatever be our role. We may be a mother, we may be a software professional, we may be a firefighter, we may be in finance, whatever it is. No, we all are parts of the social fabric, and we need to be competent. Now, sometimes some things may become very, very prominent. So normally, for example, say somebody who is a person who simply does some electrical repairs. Now that person may say, my role is so small. But if they don't do their role well properly, maybe tomorrow somebody gets electric shock and people may die because of that. So anybody who doesn't do their roles responsibly, that can lead to this deterioration, destruction of society. And those who do their roles responsibly, they contribute to the functioning of society. Say, for example, right now, I'm in India, all of you are in America, and I'm speaking. So how are we able to speak? Because there have been trained and dedicated people who were competent in their professions. They created the internet, they created the Zoom, they created the technological infrastructure by which this communication could take place. So this competence is required. Now, with respect to our analysis, we see that Durvasam, with respect to the, so this is, I'll apply all these to our discussion about so see our abilities as gifts from Krishna. So actually this is where, rather than thinking, oh, where is God out there? Why is God not helping me to deal with my problems? But actually speaking, God's help comes in even the abilities, even in the, if we get the skills by which to deal with problems. Seeing our competence as God's grace. That it is Krishna's mercy on us because of which we have our competence. So we could say, this is at three levels. To have ability is God's gift. To know that we have that ability is God's greater gift. Because many times, sometimes people have abilities, but they go through life never realizing that they have that particular ability. They may simply keep chasing after other things in life, something which is glamorized in society. in their particular culture, and they may not develop whatever abilities that they have. They may not even discover their abilities. So to know that our ability is God's gift, is God's greatest gift. To know that our ability is God's gift, is God's greatest gift. Because what happens is, we may use or abuse our abilities. But when we understand that our ability is God's gift, then we will use that ability properly. If we think that this is my ability, this is my power, I can abuse it, I can exploit others, I can do whatever I want. But if I understand that my intelligence, my singing ability, my managing ability, whatever abilities I have, these abilities are gifts given by Krishna to me. So while I have them, let me use them properly. So rather than expecting some miraculous intervention by which Krishna solves our problems, we can see that even that the competence that we have, or sometimes the competence that others have, that competence is also Krishna's mercy. So if we are sick and we go to a doctor, Krishna says, "Aham aushadham, I am medicine, I am the healing herb." So the healing potency that a doctor and their medicine has, that is actually Krishna's grace. So Krishna at one level provides us transcendence, resources for raising our consciousness. That is one way he helps us deal with our problems in this world. So amid problems, when we can't deal with them, just try to transcend them by remembering him. That opportunity for remembrance, that resource for remembrance is Krishna's gift. But along with that, we also need competence to deal with the problems. So that competence is also Krishna's grace. So whoever has that competence, and that we see them as being blessed by Krishna, and we gratefully appreciate that. And of course, we use that accordingly. And then when there is malevolence, so when there is malevolence in this world, how do we perceive Krishna's love? So sometimes that malevolence can be, we might be doing a hurtful thing towards others. Notice it so often because we rationalize it. But sometimes it can be others do malevolent things towards us. So then what is required is, there are purificatory practices for reforming. That means Krishna provides us. Actually, there is two things over here. You could put this as Shastra, or let's put it as Shastra with a double A, and there is Shastra. So Shastra is scripture and Shastra is weapons. So Krishna provides both. So there are purificatory practice for reforming. So there may be lust, anger, greed, envy, arrogance. All these things might be there in our heart, and they may make us malevolent at times. So through scripture, Krishna provides us means for transforming our hearts, for transforming lust into love, for transforming greed into gratitude, for transforming anger into forgiveness, for transforming envy into appreciation. So for transforming arrogance into humility, Krishna provides us all these resources. And that is remarkable. Sometimes when we see somebody transformed, somebody who was a very arrogant person, they become more gentle and humble. It's very enlivening to see people transform like that. So that transformatory potency is actually a mercy of Krishna. And then I'll talk about this a little bit more. And there are punitive systems. Some people may just not ready to be transformed. So if they're not ready to be transformed, then they have to be curbed. They have to be disciplined. And that's why Shastra is required. So everybody at some level or the other needs to be, every society requires both a system of, we could say, broadly speaking, if I come over here now. So countering malevolence. So we say Shastra provides education. education for transformation and shastra is regulation or retribution. Retribution means if you do something wrong, you'll be punished. So every society requires both these good things. Both these things are required in society. If there is no proper education, then what happens is human malevolence grows to terrible degrees. Now, we may in some ways say that modern education has an unhealthy absence of spirituality. But if there are no spirituality, there are no values, then what happens is that education doesn't transform people. And people may be educated, but they may be dangerous. If we consider without education, uplifting means we can say ethical or spiritual education, what happens is it is often educated people become worse threats for humanity. Because if you consider what are the biggest threats for humanity today, it could be weapons of mass destruction, they could be nuclear weapons, they could be bioweapons. Now, who's made them? It is not illiterate or educated people. These are educated people. So when you talk about education, it's not just education for getting a living, it's education for transformation. So Krishna provides us that education for avoiding the malevolence within the heart, for removing that malevolence within the heart. And when that malevolence can't be removed, then some people need to be disciplined. So sometimes as devotees, we may say we are not interested in politics. And yes, as devotees, we don't have to be obsessed with politics. But we may say that the government may not make things better much, but government can make things extraordinarily worse. That means if there is bad governance, then there is a constant threat of life, there's constant shortage of necessities. And if there is, by Shastra, it's not just weapons. Shastra is basically governance. So without it, things can become horrendously worse. So as devotees, malevolence, if there is no law and order in society, it becomes very difficult to do anything at all. We have experience of, say, devotees when they were in former Soviet Union. They were persecuted. It was very difficult to even practice bhakti at a basic level. Even now, today in China, devotees have to be underground. So malevolence can create a lot of problems. So malevolence needs to be regulated at one level through discipline, and it needs to be transformed. So when the Pandavas are fighting a war, at that time, they are trying to counter the malevolence of the Kauravas. So here, if you see, now let's apply this paradigm to the Durvasa Muni pastime, and then we'll move forward ahead to consider how this can apply in our situation. So if we apply it to Ambarish Maharaj's pastime here, by Providence's own arrangement, he faced this crisis where he suffered. What did he suffer? He suffered this terrible attack by the demons and by Durvasa Muni. So by Providence, what did he do? His unflinching absorption in the Lord, he kept him undisturbed. Then was he incompetent? No, he didn't aggravate the problem. He didn't openly flaunt his eating of the food. He didn't break the fast completely. He tried to resolve the issue. So he was not incompetent. He had competence. So by his competence, he resolved the issue so that conflict could be minimized. But still the conflict got aggravated. Durvasa Muni still got angry. So then what happened was that there was, at one level, we could say malevolence that was exhibited by Durvasa Muni. So we could say here, let's put it this way, that there was an incompetence on the part of Durvasa Muni, but that when that incompetence went down toward malevolence, Durvasa Muni tried to kill him. Now it's very easy when somebody else does something bad to us, it's our tendency to hit them back. You know, not just hit them back as hard as they have hurt, but hit them back harder than what they have hurt us. So quite often, it's we could say that test of our virtue is not when we are dealing with virtuous people, but when we are dealing with vicious people. It's easy to be virtuous . So for example, if you want to consider humility, it's easy to be humble with the humble. But the real test is, it's really tough to be humble with the proud, with the arrogant. If somebody is being very respectful and gentle and kind to us, it's relatively easy to be ourselves gentle and respectful and kind to them. But if somebody is arrogant and disrespectful and dismissive toward us, at that time, to maintain our humility, they are being rude and to stay polite, they are being aggressive and to stay calm, it's not easy. That's when our virtue is tested. So there was malevolence on the side of Durvasa Muni temporarily, but Ambarish Maharaj did not succumb to malevolence in reciprocation. What did he do? He maintained his focus on transcendence. What did he do? He had the power to the Lord said, I cannot forgive you. I cannot stop the Sudarshan Chakra from attacking you. And Ambarish Maharaj could have said, serves you right. You dared attack me. Now you bear the punishment. It's just justice. It says, it's just karmic justice. What you did, you are getting what you deserve. But he said, no. He didn't try to counter-curse. He didn't counter-curse Durvasa Muni. He didn't even try to protect himself. And he didn't even let the Sudarshan continue its work. He actually stopped. He intervened. There are three different things. If you consider Ambarish Maharaj's virtue. So, Ambarish Maharaj's forgiveness. There are multiple levels. So, if somebody hurts us, our tendency, if you hit me, I will hit you back. I will defend myself, even if that means hitting you back. So our purpose is not to hit them, but our purpose is to defend ourselves. I'll hit you back. That is a direct revengeful tendency. I'll defend myself. That is a more understandable tendency. I will let the law take its own course. That means, I won't press charges against you. But if the charges are pressed against you, I'm not going to intervene and forgive you. So if somebody hits our car or somebody does a road accident which injures us slightly, we say, I'm not going to press charges, but the police press charges. So I'm not going to intervene and say that let the police stop. But what Ambarish Maharaj does is at this third level, he has been attacked. Not only does he not attack back, not only does he not try to defend himself, when we could say the law of the Lord is taking its course and he is being attacked by Sudarshan, he says, no, I will not do this. He prays to Sudarshan Chakra to stop. Please don't hurt Durvasa Muni in any way. In fact, what he says is that if I have done any good activities, if I have done any pious activities, if I have done any devotional activities, please use those to spare Durvasa Muni. So in general, it's not a universal principle, but see, when good people do bad things, at that time we may have to seek justice. At that time, focus not on getting even, but on getting past it. What does it mean? That we all may stumble sometimes, we may all fall, and we may hurt others when we fall. When bad people do bad things, at that time, they may need to be punitively punished. The proper action might have been taken. But sometimes good people are normally good and occasionally they do some bad thing. We shouldn't hold it against them. So, we could say with respect to our family, with respect to devotee community, with respect to people that matter for us, with people who are close to us, we need to seek resolution, not retribution. You did this, so you deserve to punish. You deserve to be punished in this way. No, we want to resolve it. We don't want this particular bad thing to keep happening. But if that recurrence is not going to occur, then just move ahead. So quite often, resolution comes through forgiveness. So it's best to get past means, okay, you did this and it hurt me, but if you're not going to do it again, let's move ahead. Let's move on with it. So that's what Ambarish Maharaj exhibits over here. So the whole thing could have become much worse. We see things escalating in the Daksha Yajna, where the Daksha Yajna also is at one level a conflict between two parties, but one party curses and the other party counter curses and the other party counter curses, and everything degenerates to destruction. So what is required is, what is this? Sorry. So we need to move ahead in our life, understanding that sometimes forgiveness is what is required. So if we encounter malevolence, if it's a one-time occasion, sometimes somebody is behaving badly, just rectify it at that level and move ahead with our life. Now, if we consider, I'll conclude this part with talking about the current situation, the pandemic. What do we do at this time? If we apply this providence, incompetence, malevolence, how can we deal with it? Now, during this, overall, human society has been progressing significantly, and as compared to, say, the previous century, where there are the two world wars, the last 50, 60 years, there have been relatively not that many upheavals. And especially after the end of the Cold War, things seem to be going on relatively peacefully and prosperously. But we are always vulnerable in the world. And our vulnerability is, it's the vulnerability of our physical shells. Now we have a core which is beyond our physical shells. And when providentially this problem has come upon us, we realize that nowadays when people are working and functioning in the pandemic, they try to have a safe zone, which is called like a bio bubble. In India, there was a cricket tournament going on called the IPL. And the IPL, although there's pandemic everywhere, they had a bio bubble in which there was safety. So they're playing safely. But then what happened? The very nature of the bubble is it's going to burst. Bubbles don't last forever. So that bubble burst and many players got infected and the whole tournament had to be postponed. So we could say that we humans were living in a bubble of our own power, our own prosperity, our own greatness. And suddenly that bubble has been burst now. So at such a time, rather than simply resenting or going into negativity, we realize that our purpose is to raise our consciousness to the spiritual level. And that's what Krishna consciousness provides us. So providence is when providence sends some difficulties in our way, then we realize that's an opportunity for us to strive toward transcendence. Then what about incompetence? As devotees, each of us needs to be responsible, needs to be competent in dealing with the problem in a way that is proper. So sometimes as devotees, if we are neglectful of proper protective spiritual practices, then we may end up unnecessarily becoming spreaders of the infection, spreaders of the disease. So sometimes there is a strong opposition. Now, of course, the pandemic is abating in certain parts of the world. But if it is required that we can't assemble together because of the pandemic, then is it that we are not having faith in God? No, a part of having faith in God is to have So faith in God also includes faith in the intelligence that God has given us and our fellow humans. That faith in God doesn't mean that we don't do anything on our part. Yes, God will solve all problems. Like I gave the example, Arjuna didn't think that this is Krishna's war and Krishna will win it. No, he used his ability. So the intelligence and abilities that we have been given, we have to use them. So we can't simply say, we strive for competence in our daily dealings, in our devotional activities also. In the Islamic tradition, in the hadiths, there is a saying that every night before sleeping, remember Allah. But don't forget to tie your camel. You can't say that I'm going to remember Allah, so Allah will take care of my camel. No, tie your camel before sleeping, otherwise the camel will go away. So faith in God also includes faith in the intelligence that God has given us. So we need to be competent to do whatever it takes for dealing with the problems at a practical level. So whether it is curative medicines, whether it is preventive medicines. So the Lord gives us ability and maturity. He gives us competence to deal with it, and we should deal with it. And then, of course, malevolence. What can we do about it? So we as devotees may not be in a governing capacity, but it is at times of crisis like this. I'll conclude with this point. In the normal course of human society, people may put moral issues aside. We say morality is relative. You can have your moral views. I can have my moral views. And this idea of moral relativism is something which is very common in today's world. But when we face crisis like this, there is moral relativism. Say that you have your morality and I have my morality. But amid crisis, we realize that relativism leads to disaster. So for example, if in a pandemic like situation, there are people who start making money out of the pandemic. They start ratcheting up the prices of medicines and other resources, masks and other things. And they may say, I am doing it for my family. I am doing it for my future. But what about others present? He says, I don't concern about that. Why should I be concerned about that? He said, you think that is right? I think this is right. We can't have moral relativism. There are certain absolute principles. We don't say everything is absolute, but say if a doctor doesn't treat a patient properly, just so that the patient's disease can become exacerbated, and then the doctor can make more money out of it, that is evil. So the necessity of virtue. See, without virtue, crisis brings out the worst within us. With virtue, crisis brings out the best within us. So what happens is, as devotees, we may feel, especially in times of the pandemic, what is our practicing and sharing of Krishna Bhakti doing? So what is our sharing of Krishna Bhakti, practicing and sharing of Krishna Bhakti doing is, actually we are creating the most stable foundation for virtue. So our practice of Krishna consciousness, KC principles and practices, we can say that these are the strongest insurance against human malevolence. We can create regulatory systems, we can create government, we can create police, and all those are required. But unless there is a transcendental foundation for ethics, transcendental foundation for ethical behavior, people will not stay ethical for very long. As it is said that without spirituality, morality is largely lack of opportunity. That means people are moral because they don't have the opportunity, the resources to become immoral. That I'm not saying that everybody is not spiritual is immoral. But in crisis, what is going to stop people from doing wrong things, even terrible things, if they can gain from it? It is only if they have a bigger picture of life. It's only when they understand they have a spiritual core, that life has a spiritual purpose. So Krishna consciousness may not be seeming to solve any immediate problems right now. Yes, for that we need material competence. But Krishna consciousness actually provides the resources for countering the malevolence in the human heart. And that's how ultimately problems like this can be prevented or can be minimized. So our absorption in Krishna Bhakti is not reflecting our indifference toward the world's problems. Rather, every day that we are chanting, every day that we are hearing Bhagavatam, every day we are doing service to Krishna, we are purifying our heart. We are making the resources available for others to purify their hearts. And thereby, we are minimizing the malevolence in the world. And that's how ultimately we are contributing, not just to taking people out of the world, to Krishna, but also making this world a more habitable place where we can live more harmoniously and ultimately grow spiritually. As Srila Prabhupada would say, as Bhaktisiddhanta Thakur told Srila Prabhupada, and Prabhupada said that, Krishna consciousness is the ultimate solution to all problems. That yes, we need practical solutions to practical problems, but ultimately, if there is not a spiritual perspective, those practical solutions will not work because human malevolence will sabotage those problems. So Krishna consciousness is the ultimate solution. And it is Ambarish Maharaj's Krishna consciousness that resolves this issue gracefully. Similarly, by our Krishna consciousness, we can contribute to resolving the problems of the world at a fundamental level, at a foundational level. So I'll summarize. I spoke today on perceiving Krishna's love amid the world's distresses. So talk today about how Krishna consciousness or bhakti yoga, it helps us to counter the distresses that come because of providence, incompetence and malevolence. So providence, the problems that come, Krishna provides us many resources for raising our consciousness by which you can tolerate and transcend the problems. The world is a place of distress, but the world is also a place for gaining resources by which you can transcend the distress. The Himalayas are a place of snow, Himalaya. But it's also a place where one can achieve great things, can ascend the Everest. So Krishna provides us those resources for transcending the world's problems. And then Krishna provides us abilities and interests by which we can counter our incompetence. So the Varnashram was a system of training of organizing human society so that competent people can deal with the world's real problems. So Arjuna didn't just depend on Krishna. He strove for competence in his field of archery. And all of us, by striving for competence in our particular areas, whether they are immediately connected with spirituality or not, we are contributing to Loka Sangraha, the maintaining of social order, by which spirituality can be practiced. So Then lastly, we talked about malevolence. Malevolence is countered through Shastra and Shastra. Shastra uses education for transformation. Education to see how giving into vice is actually harmful for everyone, even for ourselves. And then the punitive systems, that is Shastra, regulate through discipline, through Kshatriyas do that through systems of regulation. So both are required. And then I talked about how these three can be applied to the pandemic, that amid this pandemic, when we were living in a bubble of human, of progress and prosperity and power, suddenly the fragility of our physical cells has become evident, and that can become like a jolt or a spur for us to seek our own spiritual, indestructible spiritual cores. So we can see a spiritual opportunity in this material adversity. Then with respect to incompetence, now we strive to be competent for taking proper precautions and doing whatever is required to minimize the spread of the pandemic. We can't be artificially transcendental. Now, faith in Krishna includes faith in the intelligence and abilities that Krishna has given us and our fellow human beings. And then lastly, I talk about malevolence. Now, catastrophes like this, they bring out the core of people. Now, if there is no cultivation of virtue, then crisis brings out the worst within us. If there has been cultivation of virtue, crisis can bring out the best within us. So our practice of Krishna consciousness is meant to counter malevolence, by which we can prevent such terrible problems from becoming worse. So rather than having moral relativism, which comes, we give a spiritual perspective, a spiritual foundation for ethical behavior. And that's how, so not only can we go beyond the world, but we can also help make the world a better place. Thank you very much. Hare Krishna.
Hi Krishna, Chaitanya Chandra, thank you so much for an amazing talk again. There is an anonymous question here. There are devotees or others who say the pandemic is untrue. It's all part of a global conspiracy. So how do that kind of a thought process fit into these solutions for these three causes of suffering?
Okay. So, you know, some devotees say that the whole pandemic is a political conspiracy. Well, at one level, Krishna has given everyone free will, and everybody can choose to believe whatever they want. And Krishna has given also intelligence to everyone. So we can also use our intelligence to find whatever evidence we want to justify our beliefs. So at one level, we respect that free will and intelligence that Krishna has given. So anybody can come up with any ideas. Having said that, Krishna consciousness doesn't have to be positioned as anti-material or anti-mainstream in every sense of the mainstream things. So can people do conspiracies? Yes, people can. Many people have done conspiracies, and conspiracies can fool a lot of people. But having said that, it requires a significant stretching of credibility credulity to think that there is a global orchestration of fraud. So now I don't want to go into specific conspiracy theories. So that there are people are dying, and many people are dying, and dying in far greater numbers than normal, it's just an undeniable fact. So now you may say that actually this is just, the deaths are not because of COVID, they are because of other factors associated with COVID, or the deaths are being just attributed to COVID. Okay, whatever it is. You know, we can debate about the specific cause of the crisis. So there could be debate about, you know, whether this was just completely a natural accident, or whether it is because of some, it is a bioweapon released by some country, or whether it is because of a combination of, say, incompetence and providence. We can go into the specifics of the causes, and there can be differences of opinion about that. And there could be differences of opinions about strategies to deal with it. But the fact, the undeniable fact is that at least if you just look at the news in India, you look at some videos, there are, you know, hospitals are overcrowded, crematoriums are overcrowded. So what exactly is the conspiracy? That there is death and devastation, that is not a conspiracy. Now, there could be some misunderstanding about the cause. So I'd say that if somebody wants to believe that, we don't have to. Krishna consciousness is not meant to be like a thought police where people can't believe what they want to believe. But at the same time, if somebody is using the influence that they have got by their spiritual stature to propagate a particular perspective, and that perspective is going to be highly damaging for the broader devotee community, then they cannot use the Krishna conscious portals for that purpose, or Krishna conscious justifications for that purpose. So, for example, you know, in India, at the start of the pandemic, there are certain religious groups who had large gatherings, and they were criticized in the press, of course, because they were of a particular minority religion. And immediately the accusations of phobia toward that religion are brought up whenever that religion is criticized. So it was much lesser. But if the same thing happens in India, say if we devotees are doing a public program and we have no precautions, and we say this whole thing is a hoax, and then somehow the pandemic spreads because of that, the kind of bad press, the press and the mainstream culture is against the mainstream religion of a particular of whichever country it is in. So, you know, it would be disastrous for our movement. So if some devotees want to take that position individually that, okay, the whole pandemic is a hoax and whatever else they want to take, that is fine. But if they start saying that they start using whatever followers they have got through Krishna conscious circles for propagating that, then what are they doing is, in the public eye, they start getting associated. People start associating Krishna consciousness with that. And the result of that would be, it can lead to a lot of, I would say, at least in India, with the current pandemic kind of situation, not only temples can be closed down, but temples, you know, ISKCON's public profile can suffer irreparable damage. If we just carelessly neglect regulations. Of course, devotees have been doing kirtans and other things, but that was during a time when the COVID seemed to have abated for some time. But so now we may say that, okay, if Krishna consciousness is transcendental, then why take one position? Why take the mainstream position? Well, it's not that officially there are any ISKCON channels which are mandating to devotees, you know, you have to do this and you have to do this and you have to do that. That's up to left to the individual free will. But as a movement, the movement's leaders have to think about the bigger picture. And because we are a global movement, there will be ramifications at various places. So I would say that I'll conclude this point by saying that there is a tendency that when we start practicing bhakti, there is a tendency to have the we-they mentality. That we are virtuous, we are good, we are spiritual. And they means all those people out there in the material world, they're all bad people. They're all demoniac, they're all evil, they're all selfish. Yes, they are. There are definitely people like that. So is Big Pharma exploitative? Yes, of course, Big Pharma is exploitative. But does that mean the whole medical industry is simply based on exploitation? You know, if we start saying that, you know, we are overlooking, we are actually seeing, we are not seeing people as parts of Krishna. Yes, everybody is covered by conditionings, but still beyond their conditionings, everybody is a part of Krishna. And everybody has a potential for virtue within them. And that potential for virtue, that potential for goodness is manifested at different degrees in different people. So we hope and we seek that in devotees that we are parts of God. So we have a potential for godliness and goodness. That godliness and goodness is manifested to a large degree in devotees. But just because somebody is not a devotee doesn't mean that they are not a part of God. And that doesn't mean that their core divinity is completely obscured. So there are hardworking, virtuous people in the world who are also striving to do good. So in the medical industry, I know devotee friends and non-devotee friends. I studied in one of the top engineering colleges in India. And most students there were out there for just to have a career and money. But there were principled people, principal young people who actually thought that by their work in engineering, they can do good to the world. So there are hardworking, diligent, virtuous people also out there. And we don't have to have this black and white view where the mainstream is all filled with conspiracy and it's all bad. No, there could be conspiracies and there could be areas, pockets of conspiracy might be there. Certain things might be exaggerated. Certain things might be distorted. Yes, that's there. But that doesn't mean that we just dismiss the gravity of the catastrophe that is visiting humanity right now. And that doesn't mean we dismiss or trivialize the measures that are being sought for countering that catastrophe. So are these the best measures? Probably not. But you know, one of the predicaments of, we could say the existential predicament of humanity is that we have to deal with huge problems with limited information. That's just the way we live in our day-to-day life also. You know, suppose somebody wants to, say, get married. Now, how much do we know about the other person to actually enter into a formal relationship with them? We can't know much, but still life goes on. And we have to take, in one sense, a leap of faith. So similarly, when we are trying to deal with whatever crisis has come today, nobody has the full information. And have people made mistakes? Yes, everybody has made mistakes. But we are trying our best. So we means not just devotees, but human society is trying its best to deal with this problem. And we should cooperate with that. So my conclusion would be that, you know, yes, everybody can have their view, even within the devotee community. But they shouldn't use Krishna conscious justification for their own views, and they can't use Krishna conscious positions that they have acquired for their Krishna consciousness to propagate their views. So, and as far as the broader Krishna conscious community is concerned, the leadership of the Krishna conscious community is concerned, then they have to consider what is best for the long-term perspective. And from the broader perspective of broader perception and purpose of sharing Krishna consciousness, and they will act accordingly. I hope that answers the question.
Thank you very much, Prabhu. Hi, Krishna. If anybody else has any questions or comments, please feel free to share your question. Mother, again, you should be able to unmute.
Okay, now I can unmute. Yeah, hi, Krishna Prabhu. I think today you said that the nature of the jiva is to be progress seekers, if I remember correctly.
Yes.
And yesterday you said that by nature we are pleasure seekers. And so I think it's an obvious point, but I just needed to hear you clarify for me that although we are by nature pleasure seekers,
it's the same thing in the sense that, see, we seek pleasure, but we seek better and better pleasure. We're not just satisfied with the same pleasure all the time. I give the example of food. There is pleasure in eating food, but we want to eat more and more delicious food. You know, very few human beings, if we were told that for the rest of your life, morning, afternoon, evening, you have the same diet every day, every meal for the rest of our life. We want pleasure and we want variety of pleasure. So in that sense, we say our pleasure seeking tendency is expressed through our seeking progress, to try to improve things, to try to seek better pleasures. And ultimately, this progressive tendency is meant to be directed toward not just material improvement, but spiritual elevation. Why is it that humans have the capacity for, when we say humans have the capacity for spirituality and animals don't, what does it mean? It means that humans actually can seek higher pleasure than what is naturally available at the physical level. So all living beings are pleasure seeking at one level, we can say. Animals seek it through food, to eating, to mating, and other things like that. We humans also seek it through that way, but we seek more. We seek more than what is naturally available. And that more can be directed at the material level, and we try to improve things materially. But ultimately, that seeking for progress that is meant to direct our consciousness toward the spiritual level.
Yeah, actually, I was misleading in juxtaposing our pleasure-seeking tendency against our progress-seeking tendency. What I really meant to ask was, you know, as pleasure-seekers, you know, the implication is that our pleasure-seeking tendency is selfish, you know? But the nature of the soul, as I understand, is to seek Krishna's pleasure, not our own pleasure.
Well, I mean, it's a little...
I mean, that's the problem
pleasure,
with...
To call our pleasure-seeking tendency as selfish, I would say is a little harsh. It is just that we can say that the pleasure-seeking potency is there within us because it is there within Krishna. And because we are parts of Krishna, so Krishna has a super Krishna, one of the names is Ram. Ram means Ramati, Ramayati, Iti Ram. One who delights and one who gives delight, that is Ram. So we are his parts. So our pleasure-seeking tendency is because we are parts of Krishna and he has a pleasure-seeking tendency. So the problem is not with the pleasure-seeking tendency, the problem is with where we are directing the pleasure-seeking tendency. So when we direct it toward Krishna, now when we say we should seek Krishna's pleasure, that doesn't mean Krishna wants his pleasure at the expense of our pleasure. Krishna wants us to be happy, not that Krishna wants himself to enjoy and he wants to keep us miserable. Bhakti is not like that. Of course, in bhakti, there are some limbs which sometimes require us to do austerities, which means embracing some misery at times. But overall, bhakti is a process where if we consider, say, our pleasure is one circle, and Krishna's pleasure is another circle, the jiva operates in the intersection of the two. So that's why there are different rasas. And Yashodamai is not, Krishna doesn't expect Yashodamai to serve in the Dasya rasa. Her pleasure-seeking tendency is that she wants to serve Krishna in the mood of her parent. And Krishna arranges that. Of course, that's at a transcendental level. But even if we consider at the worldly level, the whole system of Varanashram and Daivi Varanashram, if we consider, the idea is that there are things which are naturally, sometimes the word pleasurable or enjoyable has a negative connotation within bhakti. But we could say that are naturally relishable for us. A person who is of a Brahminical nature, for them studying scripture is naturally enjoyable. And they do that, but they do that in Krishna's service. A person who is a Kshatriya, they are movers and shakers. They want to get things done. And Krishna doesn't tell them, okay, you stop doing all things that you would like to do and just sit and study scripture. No. He says, you do what you like to do, but do it for Krishna's, do it in a dharmic cause. Do it in a mood of bhakti. So, it's not that our pleasure-seeking tendency is selfish. It is rather presently the way we are way our pleasure-seeking tendency is directed is ignorant. So, the more we become informed, well-informed or enlightened about how pleasure is to be found in a healthy way, then that pleasure-seeking tendency is what enables us to act and serve Krishna. And when we serve Krishna, it gives pleasure to him and gives pleasure to us also. So what is required in Krishna consciousness is not to curb or crush the pleasure-seeking tendency, but to not seek pleasure in places that take us away from Krishna, in things that take us away from Krishna. Does that answer your question?
Yeah, I guess I just maybe need to meditate a little bit more on why it is not selfish if our pleasure-seeking tendency is not directed toward Krishna. Why is that harsh? You know, it's unnatural for the soul to not direct our pleasure-seeking toward Krishna's pleasure.
No, okay. So, but the presence of the pleasure-seeking tendency is not selfishness. Pleasure-seeking tendency itself is natural. So we could say the present direction of the pleasure-seeking tendency is selfish. But it's not that pleasure-seeking tendency itself is selfish.
Uh-huh.
Pleasure-seeking tendency is intrinsic to us because it is there in Krishna. So yes, the way it is directed mm-hmm. is currently selfish.
Okay. Uh-huh. Okay. Okay. Thank you, Prabhu.
And there's one quick comment. I think first question was there. That is, so Shastra is basically equivalent to a jail because it's a punitive system for restraining. Well, first it is not, Shastra is weapons. So I was using weapons. Weapons are what Kshatriyas use. And now it's not jail. Weapons are not used simply to put people in jail. Weapons can also be used to keep borders safe so that people can live in a protected, safe environment. Weapons can also be used by the police to keep order in society so that people can function. So when I talk about systems for restraining, punitive systems doesn't mean that everybody has to be punished. But there are invaders who have to be punished. There are lawbreakers who have to be punished. The point I was making is that within the scriptural tradition, there are Brahmanas who provide Shastra for transforming, and there are Kshatriyas who use Shastra, who use weapons. So Shastra is used for not just punishing everyone, but even the fear of punishment is also a means of regulating people. As it is said in the Bible, biblical tradition, that fear of God is the beginning of wisdom. So to some extent, the punitive systems, whether it's actually implemented or whether it's just there, where we know that it will come upon us, that can regulate us. Okay, thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Prabhu.
Mantra Srimad Bhagavatam ki jai.
His grace Chaitanya ki jai.
Gaur Bhaktavinda ki jai. Jai Gaur Premanandi.
Thank you so much.
Hare Krishna.